Hey, welcome back. We're going to do something really cool in this video. We're going to use one lens to photograph and we're going to scan those negatives with the same lens. So come and join us, watch this video. You're going to learn a lot of stuff. I'm going to show you how to use this Zuiko lens, this macro lens. You can use it on a mirrorless camera, analog camera, do some really cool video close-ups. It's a very flexible lens and the best of all, it costs buttons. It's so inexpensive. So I'm back on the streets of Graz with my OM1 camera and I'm going to use this macro lens. Lockdown here has been eased up a little bit, which is great. We've got to take our precautions, but I'm going to take some shots and show you how great this lens is. I'm going to talk about the Zuiko lens. The Zuiko macro lens is a 50mm lens that goes to f3.5, and the wonderful thing about this compact lens is that you can extend it all the way out and it works to a distance of 0.25. now that's really close, and that's what this lens is. It's really super for doing copy work or close-up work or macros. That's what it was designed for, and it's got an aperture ring in the front here that goes up to f22. The lens is well protected, the front element's well protected. You don't really need a UV filter, so you can actually just throw this lens in your camera bag and not worry about it too much. They're relatively inexpensive and they're very, very easy to pick up. Now, one of the things about this lens is they are really sharp and well made, and it can also be just used as a normal 50mm lens. That's because of the design of the lens. The lens is a helioid type of lens, as you can see here as it extends out. It's really one of those lenses that you really need to have if you have an Olympus camera, and the wonderful thing is you can use this, of course, on a mirrorless camera, as I said, with an adapter. So a little bit about the design of the lens. It's a five elements in four groups, multi-coated. Most of them are multi-coated. There is a version that wasn't multi-coated. Avoid that version. The angle of view is 47 degrees. The reproduction ratio is about half life size, and the length is about 40mm, and the weight is 200 grams or 7 1/8 of an ounce. You don't need extension tubes with this lens and you don't need a bellows. So that's what's wonderful about this little macro lens. You can use this lens with an extension tube of 24mm if you want 1-to-1. But I think Olympus recommended the 80mm lens, the F4 lens, using the bellows system if you really want to do kind of really close up macro stuff. But to be honest, this is such a great lens. So I took it out in the streets of Graz and I made some images just around the neighborhood.
So I photographed the first two, one with the church door handle and then the wrought iron, both at 1/30th of a second, actually 1/60th of a second at f3.5. And then I further went on to photograph the Mercedes van, both at 1/30th of a second at 3.5. All so far being pushed to 400 ASA. So let's see what else I can find.
As I said, this lens costs buttons, so why not just photograph buttons? I've got my mirror lockup set here, cable release, the camera's on a tripod, and an LED light to give a little bit of atmosphere. I'm shooting at f8 at 1/15th of a second. The little Zuiko is quite capable of scanning your negatives too. To achieve this, you need a light table. I would recommend an LED version, they're inexpensive. In my case, I really wanted to complete the proof of concept, so to speak. Therefore, I used a free app called Light Table on my Android phone. I'm pretty sure it's available on the iOS too. Now, I set up my mirrorless camera on a tripod over the mobile phone and made sure it was on a flat surface and placed a piece of glass over my negative and proceeded to take an image. Now, I focused manually. And here are some tips to ensure that you correctly focus. First thing you need to do is turn on your highlight alerts on your camera, your blinkies as they call it. Zoom into the negative, into the grain of the negative, and focus manually as sharp as possible. So you want also your exposure manual, and I would go with f8. Whatever macro lens you're using, or in this case the Zuiko lens. Set your camera to the base ISO. On a Fuji camera, this tends to be 200 ISO. Other cameras can be 100 or 160, depending which camera you have. You need a cable release, or if you don't have a cable release, use a self-timer. In my case, I used the threaded cable release, the same one that I actually used on the analog camera. Also, switch on your histogram, because you'll need that to just give you an idea where the exposure is. Now, you want that exposure to climb the wall on the right hand side. Now you probably want to go as far as overexposing it, because you want to expose for the notches in the film, so they should be blinking pretty hard, and then just keep overexposing until you find that it's starting to see blinkies in the actual image itself, and then you should dial it back. Shoot in RAW and JPEG, or just RAW. If you're going to shoot JPEG, shoot it fine, but I recommend shooting RAW, and that will basically get you up and running. Now, you got to remember, when you're into Photoshop, you're going to invert this image, because it will be a negative, and so you've got to keep in mind about that histogram. Now, that'll get you pretty much, you know, very basic, very cheap, using a phone and the lens. Now, you can go a bit further and get a proper copy stand. You can also check out Negative Lab Pro. This is an excellent program. Unfortunately, it only works as a Lightroom plugin. I'm hoping that this guy will release, I think it's Nate Johnston, he will release this for Capture One, because that's the program I like to use. It is an excellent program, especially for color. So I'm going to put a comparison of my scanner, my flatbed scanner, which is a Canon 9000F, against the image that I took with the Fuji XE3 with the Zuiko 50mm lens. And you can see that there's pretty much not much in it. I mean, if I tweaked it a bit more, and certainly if I changed the light table, because you could see the patterns of the pixels of the phone. Certainly to improve the quality of the negative image, would be better to use a film holder, something that you get with a scanner, or you could print one off if you've got a 3D printer. I'm going to follow this up in another video that goes a bit more into scanning your negatives, because in this video it's long enough and I don't really want to get into this and add more to this video. It's mainly about the Zuiko lens and what you can do with it. So let's go through the macro images that I've taken. Here is one. This was just after the rain, and we had a few raindrops left and a few leaves here. This is in Photoshop, so let me just, yep. Probably needs, there's a little line here that we need to take off. A few little dots here and here. Might add in some levels just to make it a bit more. Yeah, that looks nice. So pretty much it. Not much work has to be done on this. Let's just have a look at the next one. Okay, these are the buttons. Okay, I used an LED light to take these guys. I mean, look at the detail. This is just incredible. Probably my dodgy fixer here. A few little bits of dust and stuff, but that's about it. We got so much dust here, so that I used distilled water for my chemicals, and that's mainly because of the calc in the water, but also the dust in the air doesn't help either. Yeah, I could do with a film dryer, but hey, I don't have space for that right here at the moment. Okay, so let's have a look at the... So the button detail is pretty nice. I think I did two shots of the button. So basically all I'm doing here is using this healing brush over here. And that's Control J on a Windows machine and Apple J on a Mac. So that looks, let's zoom out here. Yeah, that looks pretty nice. That's a really, I haven't done any sharpening at all. I tend to do the sharpening when I resize the image for the final output, and that's the way you should do resharpening. You shouldn't really apply sharpening at all until your final output. So let's switch on to another one. Okay, that's another shot, similar one. We could do the same again here with the levels. Let's have a look. Yeah, the levels look pretty good. Bring our blacks, that looks super. So we can see down here straight away. Let's just zoom in again. Yeah, there's a few little bits and bobs that need to be cleaned up. Let's switch to the background layer. Okay, so the detail is phenomenal from this lens. It's really, really awesome. Also, the film is this fine grain film from Ilford. The Pan F is really good, which I shot at 50 ASA. Okay. So let's zoom back out here. Yeah, that looks really, really nice. So let's have a look at the next image. Yeah, okay, looks like I wasn't really doing that pretty well. Let's move on. Okay, this one I did handheld. The others that you've seen now, I've done with a tripod and mirror lockup on the OM1. The mirror lockup on the OM1, you'll see in the video, that it's just on the side of where the lens is, and you just turn this little kind of a round little switch kind of thing, and that does the mirror lockup, and it blockens out the viewfinder, so that prevents kind of this mirror slap, which if you don't know what that means, basically it is when you take the shot, the mirror will make such a noise or such a vibration that it will, you know, take some sharpness away from your image. So if you're doing something that takes a lot of time, it's important to use a mirror lockup. Not all analog cameras have a mirror lockup, by the way. That's one of the advantages of the OM1. So let's have a look at the, let's just zoom in here. Yeah, that looks pretty cool. This is on a run out to Puntigam when we were cycling, and I said, okay, I like that kind of graffiti. I was hoping it would be a little bit more brighter, but it's turned out quite nice. So let's get on to the next one. Ah, okay. This one is, I found this in the middle of town, actually. This is an old hutte, an old cabin, basically. It was kind of in one of the grounds of probably a convent or something. I don't know why it's there, but... It came out all right, but the difference, I think, there's the next one, right? This was without the mirror lockup. For some reason, this did not come out too well. So, some more detail, but I'm going to show a better one than that. Okay, let's have a look at this one. I think that needs to be rotated. So let's have a look. Let's press it. Yeah. That could be rotated around, but for the moment, I think I'll just do the levels. Okay, let's just do the levels. Looks like it's upside down. Yeah. I did this also with a tripod with the mirror lockup. These were just some dead pine ferns that were just lying on the ground. The detail's amazing. Yeah, again, this is what you have to do with film photography. You got to go through all your images, get rid of all the debris and dust and stuff. I mean, yeah, I could have shot it with the rocket blower, you know, to blow off the dust from the negative. But my rocket blower is actually in my darkroom at the moment, which I'll probably get this weekend. Actually, I'm going to go up there. and actually going to use the enlarger, and maybe I'll even enlarge one of these negatives and print it for real with the Ilford filters, which I'm dying to use. I haven't used them at all. So let's have a look at that guy in full screen. That looks quite nice, actually. Yeah, let's have a look what's next. Okay, we need to crop the top off here, no problem. It's not so sharp. Yeah, that's kind of a failure. Ah, I like this one. Don't know what the side of the, why I have these light blobs on the side here. Could be that that's how it was, or I could have had a leak or something. I'm gonna crop them out. They take away from the image. Yeah, that looks much better. And let's have a look. Yeah, just a little bit of debris here. Nothing much, actually. It's really, really nice. As I said, I haven't done any sharpening at all to this, and I haven't increased the exposure at all. Actually, I can go back into Silver Effects here and have a look if I can find that. Have that image there, but no, I don't. That's still in the scanner. Yeah, now we go back in here. I wanted to have a look if we could see if it was in Silver Effects. Basically, I use the standard settings in Silver Effects, nothing, no extra things. And it's coming out really, really nice. Developed in Ilford DDX. It was the Ilford DDX for 8 minutes. It was 8 minutes, yeah. If you don't have Ilford DDX, Rottenau is also very good for 50 ASA. Any film that's under 200 ASA is good with Rottenau. Okay, so a little bit of a crop here. Okay. I also want to try and use this lens to scan these negatives. But for the moment, I just want to. Okay. For the moment, I just want to see how they look on a normal scanner. I'm using a Canon 9000F scanner because I can't afford an Epson fancy V700, whatever they are. So we'll be using this little Canon one, which I have for a while. It's good. It works pretty well. It does medium format as well. But I would like to use DSLR to do the negative. So what I'm doing here is I'm just bringing up the blacks, and let's have a look. Yeah, that's about right. I like that. I took the same shot of this on color, actually. So let's just go to the heating brush and just. Oh, we need to change our layer. Hold on. Let's change the background layer. Okay, now we have it. Zoom in here. Detail also super from the lens, and this is not a macro, this is just a standard shot, of course. So that this just goes to show this lens is well capable of just being a standard 50 as well as being a macro lens. So that's the, I mean, it's not the fastest lens, but it's definitely, if you want to go out with one lens and do quite a number of things, this is a good one to take with you. I mean, I'm quite partial to wide angle lenses. I like the 24mm and I like 35mm. I like 50. These are probably my three favorite focal lengths, to be honest. So that looks pretty much done. I like that. Has a good atmosphere to it. And the leaves on the top for a bit of framing. It's kind of a nice way to do things. Okay, let's see what's next. The umbrella. This was funny. I came across, this was yesterday actually, when we were cycling out, and I came across these old glass houses, and there was a few, and I really just wanted to finish off the film so that I could actually get the development done and put together this video, because it'd been going on quite a long time, and it was proving quite difficult to do so many macros. And the truth be told, the first reel that I, or the first roll of film I used, Didn't work out very well at all. I had some difficulty with it and that was a complete disaster. So I had to shoot everything again. So that's why I'm a bit delayed this week and I'm bringing out the video. But I love this shot. It was just an umbrella hanging in the glasshouse, and there's so much detail in the print here. So it's just, so I'm using the swear brackets here to reduce the size of my healing brush again. So we just a few little dots. That's probably from my dodgy fixer. It's important to get rid of all the lumps in your fixer. That happens when it gets oxidated, I guess. I could just put it through some cotton wool and all that stuff would come out. But it's, to be honest, it's not so bad. It's pretty to be expected. I probably should just make some fresh fixer, to be honest. Yeah. Okay, that looks pretty good. So let's just look at that again. That's kind of nice. I like that image. So let's see what the next one is. Yeah, this was inside the glass. That's not a spectacular image, but it's kind of documentary and I just wanted to include it so it gives you an idea of the glass house. I mean, I wasn't supposed to be in here. It was somebody else's property and just stuck my head in the door and took a shot. So, okay, this is the Mercedes van and this is the side window shot. And I just love the textures. That's what I was going for. It's full of dust and probably pollen because we've got a lot of pollen in the air. And this came out really nice. The tones are lovely on this film. I really like the tones on Ilford Pan F. So we can zoom in here and you can see the detail. Again, no sharpening. So I've no sharpening any of these images. So over here, I could just clean that up a little bit. I just see a little bit of dirt here. Okay, that's kind of done. Yeah, so let's have a look what the next one is. Oh yeah, this was in the front of the window of the Mercedes van. And there's this clock that was kind of warped due to the heat, and I just try to capture it. It's kind of tricky, but I also like that I have two shots of this, so this is the first one. So let's see if the next one, yeah, there's the second one. And this one, you can read what's on the map, and you've got a tweezers here, and there must be a knife, and the texture of this, I don't know what it looks like, a sponge or something. I like both of these shots. They're kind of slightly abstract, and that's what I was going for. So, let's see what else we've got. And this is kind of a straight-on architectural shot. I just like the light in the building, and yeah, the old sign on top. So as you can see, the lens is capable of doing quite a few things. And this is again, this is a macro lens of the church door. This, you can see quite a lot of nice detail on that. That's really nice. It's from, I think, 1890 is this door handle. Really nice tones in that. And this is the front of the Mercedes van, and it really just picks up all the detail. Look at that, my goodness. I mean, there's nothing wrong with this lens. For 50 bucks, you can't complain. Really cannot complain. Okay, for all those guys, everyone out there who's like into, you know, corner sharpness and all that stuff. You can see it's fine. Okay, so I'm not into all those kind of charts, which is the sharpest lens and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, it's more important to make a nice image. So here, this was the back of the Mercedes van. I kind of, again, wanted to make a little bit more abstract so the viewer kind of thinks, what am I looking at? And kind of give a small sneaky impression of what could be. And the idea is that you see this hat in the back of the van and you don't really see into the van. So yeah, it leaves you to your imagination what it could be. I love the up here we have some cobwebs. This van's been sitting for quite some time, and a nice bit of rust. Rust is always lovely to photograph. And the texture of the paint has been repainted a few times, obviously. I mean, it's the detail that's been picked up is really nice. and it's telling the story as it should. So with the film and the lens, it's a great combo. So this is the side of the Mercedes van. You can see where that clock is there, where it's okay. Yeah, this is a rose shot, probably better in color, to be truly honest. You can see all the pollen around it sitting on it. Again, it's okay, it's not a spectacular shot, but I just want to see how close I can get, and this is pretty much the closest you'll get with the macro lens without extension tubes. So this is I think what is it, 0.25 is so that's 25 millimeters, isn't it? I think, okay, or maybe that's the closest one, but yeah, so that was the idea. It was a beautiful red rose, probably better on Kodak Color Plus or another color film. So I kind of really got hooked on the textures of things, and went to do photograph, find a bicycle that kind of had those textures, and I liked the cracked rubber here and the mudguard with the broken paint. And Graz is full of bikes. I mean, if you live in Graz, you have to have a bike, at least two bikes. That's the kind of the mandate. So this is nice. This is nice. This is only around the corner, actually, in the university grounds. I found these trees. And they are lovely. Really, really, really nice. It's a really beautiful shot. Yeah. And that's Pan F. That's really, it's a really contrasty film. So, more buttons. Yeah, more detail. Again, wonderful detail again in the buttons. I think I took two shots of buttons with the LED light and on the tripod with cable release. This is actually the greenhouse. And I really, really like the cracked putty, and you can see that this was put in by hand. And I mean, it's, everything is starting, you know, nature's, it's starting to have a go. The rust is, you know, the iron is starting to rust and the putty is starting to crack. And it's just the last bit of putty is holding that plate of glass in there, and the dirt on the glass. And yeah, I don't know. It is slightly abstract, and it is a study of shape and form. I really like it. For me, it lets you think. So let's just make it a little smaller. Yeah, that's probably one of my favorites. So let's go to the next one. Okay, that one underexposed. Okay, and that's another detail, one of the trees. It's okay. It's not bad. Doesn't really tell you very much what it is. I had the dymo on the bike, so that's okay too. More buttons. I think I have a few button shots. And the leaves with the water droplets. More buttons. I'm probably going around again. Okay, that's pretty much it. And let's not leave it on that one. Let's run away. Okay, I hope you enjoyed looking at these images and giving you a little bit of a background about the images. If you haven't already subscribed, please hit that subscribe button. Don't forget to hit the little notification bell, and hope to see you on the next video. Goodbye.